And okay, so we will be learning a lot today about the use of social media for fundraising. So, about the course. So, what we'll do is we will understand the nature of online and social media platforms. That's what we will do. And then we'll know how to use those social media platforms for the purpose of fundraising. The social media platforms can be used for many purposes. For this particular session, we're going to learn how to use it for fundraising. And then I'd like you to design a social media fundraising campaign by the end of the day. Okay, so and here's an outline of our of what we're going to go through today. I'll give you an overview. I'll give you a perspective of how big this is and what the implications are. And then I'll show you a framework written by Michael Hyatt. It's called Platform. And basically, we'll talk about making sure that you have a great idea. So you start with wow. And then you have to gear up for it, so which means you prepare to launch. I'll talk to you about the social media framework in building your home base. And then I'll show you some strategies on how to execute it and how to implement the campaign as you expand your reach and engage your tribe. Sometime later towards the end of the day, you'll be grouping yourselves together. I think we can have two groups, okay? One group of four and another group of five. You will help each other come up with a campaign, and then you will present it at the end of the day, okay? So, because this is ATS, you will have to begin with a bit of theology. And I'd like to always connect this with, so what the gospel has to do with this? What does social media have to do with the gospel? Okay, so let's begin with the most important thing. Let's talk about the gospel. Okay? And if we get a bit technical, we'll learn that it's about good news. Okay? And in fact, the evangelism came directly from a translation of the gospel, Evangelion. And which means if you go down into the meaning of these words, an evangelist, therefore, is a bearer of good news, or good stories, a good proclamation. And evangelism is about the proclamation of the good news. We all know this, okay? But I'd like to show you the connection between this and what we're going to do. Okay, I'd like to share with you some ideas about the use of evangelism, the declaration of the good news. When originally in the first century, when they started talking about this, it is being used, Evangelion is being used by the Roman emperor or whoever's in control of the empire. Okay, and whenever they invade a city, they take over a city, they don't kill everybody, they just, they just kill the tribe head and the soldiers, and then they basically let everybody else go scot-free. Well, not scot-free, but they are free to do their daily business, okay, for as long as they pay their they recognize the sovereignty of the new emperor. Okay, so after the invasion and the soldiers are defeated, the old king has been deposed and decapitated perhaps, they go to the agora, or they go to the marketplace, and they make a proclamation. The announcer, the bearer of good news, the evangelist, goes there and makes a royal proclamation. Hear ye. He makes a royal proclamation. He brings the good news, the gospel, that Good news, you have a new Lord. You have a new emperor. You have a new king. And it is Caesar who is Lord. Good news, and because he is Lord, everything will be fine. You can go, you know, you can make money, do trade. You're free to do whatever you want to do for as long as you bow down before the new king. If you bow down before the new king, we're okay. We're okay. We will live in peace. And we will assure you that we will be protected when you travel from one place to another because our Roman soldiers will be there. We'll take care of you. That's a royal proclamation. So, when you hear it like this, it sounds a bit like the gospel. The gospel that we know, because after all, when the Apostle Paul started talking about the gospel, he was actually using that same word. He was sharing the good news, the evangelion, the proclamation that no, it is not Caesar who is Lord. There is a new king. There is a new Lord. The Messiah of Israel is the new Lord. If you will read it in Romans 1, chapter 1, verse 1 to 4, you will read that here's Paul making that proclamation. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the evangelion of God, the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand to his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. And what is that gospel of God? This is concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead. And who is this new Lord? Jesus Christ, our Lord. That is his royal proclamation. He is trumping, pardon the term, he is trumping the royal proclamation of the Roman Empire. He is saying, Jesus is the true Lord, not only of the Roman Empire, but the Lord of all. That's what he's saying. So what does this have to do with social media? Let's do a little commentary on this. I looked this up. This is one of my favorite theologians, N.T. Wright. This is what he said. The gospel is the royal announcement that the crucified and risen Jesus, who died for our sins and rose again according to the Scriptures, has been enthroned as the true Lord of the world. Okay? And then, therefore, the task of evangelism is the proclamation that Jesus is already Lord, that in him, God's new creation is broken into history, and that all people are therefore summoned to submit to him in love, worship, and obedience. So this sounds like there is a declaration of a new Lord in a small kingdom. There is a new Lord, and therefore everybody must bow down before the new king, and we'll be okay. It sounds like that, right? Okay, that's basically it. The declaration that Jesus Christ is Lord has certain implications in the lives of people. And we are, everybody, not just Christians, everybody is summoned, is called to bow down before the new king. We are summoned to submit to him in love, worship, and obedience. The logic of the message requires that those who announce it, the evangelists, the Christians, the people of God, those who announce it should be seeking to bring Christ's lordship to bear on every area of human and worldly existence. Jesus is Lord of all, and which means every part of our lives must be subject to it, should be submitted to his lordship. Everything that we do should be done for his glory. Okay? Now we're getting nearer to social media. Okay. What is social media? Social media is very much like our public witness. we live as followers of Jesus Christ, we have our public lives displayed before other people. And when whatever we do, we say, this is my witness to my Lord. What I do because of the calling of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so I do this with all my, with the best that I can do, with excellence, with compassion, with concern, with love, because I do this not for my sake, not for other people's sake, which of course we have to be concerned about, but more importantly, I do this because I want to honor my Lord. That's my public witness. Social media is just the same. Okay? So it, as we read these verses, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. And in the physical world, this is limited to the people who see it. In the social media, this gets expanded a bit more. Because whatever you post online gets seen by your friends, by your fans, by your enemies even, and they get to see what you do. So it's very important what you post on social media. So if you keep posting cats, social, that's okay. You love animals, but you have to be aware. You have to be conscious that what you do is not only for yourself, it is also your public witness. It is your public face seen by other people, and people make a conclusion, make a judgment, make a, form impressions about you based on what they see or what they read that you post. Okay? You have to be concerned. We have to be mindful of what we do. In Colossians 3:17, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. So whatever you post, we say, happy birthday, my friend Johnny. May the Lord bless you and keep you. People get to read what you post, and they make certain judgments and conclusions based on what they see that you post. Okay? If you do it with the mindset that what I'm doing this because I want to glorify the Father, I want God to, I'm doing this for the sake of God's name. I'm doing this because I want to glorify Christ. Then it will come out. You don't have to explicitly state it like that. You should every now and then, but what you do should be infused with this sense that this guy who's on social media is not just doing this for whatever. This guy has a higher purpose. This guy has, there's something about this guy that is just, empowering him and driving this post is something that's divine, something that's transcendent. Okay, hopefully that's what people conclude from our post. And so, just a bit more extension from that, from social media as a public witness. Just a bit, one step more, social media, when we use it for fundraising, it is all about nurturing a community of people who are supporting what you do. Okay? Because social media is all about building relationships and nurturing the relationships, building communities. And as you share stories, and people love stories, people get to see what you do, or get to see an aspect of your personality. It's all about what is this guy all about. And in Ephesians chapter 2, it says that We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which He prepared in advance for us to do. There are certain good works which He prepared in advance for us to do, and we'd like to share it. Okay? The good works that God has prepared us to do, we share it online. And somehow, those stories of good works may resonate with certain people, especially if those stories has significant impact on the lives of other people. Somehow, in our humanity, we are drawn into a story of, you know, of compassion, of joy, of you know, great stories of heroes and heroines and people being saved and people being helped, and people are naturally drawn to these kinds of stories. When we share those stories with other people, somehow they get drawn into the story. Okay? They are pulled in. They are attracted to those stories. Those stories resonate with something that's important to them, with their values and perspectives. They are drawn to it, and they want to join in. Or at least want to listen in initially. They want to hear what's happening. They're interested in how you're doing it. They get drawn in a bit more until eventually they become part of the story. They become part of that community. So you invite people to your story of good works, and they become part of the community. Part of that, and this is where fundraising comes in, part of that storytelling is sharing with them about the need of this big task that you have to accomplish. This is such an inspiring thing that we need to do. There's a lot of obstacles, there's a lot of struggle, and you know, we can't fully do it if we don't have the resources. And how we wish other people would, you know, would come in and help out. If you tell that story, the story that way, to a people who are already interested or drawn into the story, then it is easier to ask them, invite them in deeper into the story, and actually participate in that story, making that story their own. They become a participant in that story. They become part of that community working on this great task. Okay, that's how you use social media. Okay? You get it? Okay, class is missed. That's it. That's the basic idea. Okay? So this is not about social media. This is about, you know, building a community of people who are working together on something important for the glory of God. That's what it's all about.